Welcome back to NTAC Live. I'm Chris Walsh, and we're in Grand Rapids, Michigan at NTAC 2012, talking to the people that make this an amazing summer event that everybody in network and out of network has to be at. And of course, today we had a great keynote from Dennis Litke, and he's joined us now.
Thank you. It's good to be here and good to see 1,500 people so excited. So
well, I mean, what this is a big step for our conference as well to have you, because we are cousins, if you will, through big picture learning, and we've been trying to reach out and really learn from each other over the last few years in that work together. And it's exciting to have you here come and reach out to all of our folks here at NewTek and bring some of that.
One of the things I said in my speech is that too often these groups that are kind of like each other stay in their own corner and compete. And the fact that you brought me here just says here are two big networks with over 100 schools each that are getting together and sharing those resources. Yeah. So it's exciting, and we should do more of that.
Oh, absolutely. So, and your conference has a similar title, I hear.
Yes. This is deep, what is it? Deeper.
Dive into deeper learning.
And ours is deep dive or something. We didn't even know it.
Well, we'll all get the scuba gear on later.
That's right.
So I think maybe for some people who didn't hear your keynote or maybe new to some of the work of Big Picture, maybe you can start by talking a little bit about what Big Picture does, why it's unique and different, and maybe a little bit of even how it got started.
Yeah. Well, Big Picture is a nonprofit started by myself and Elliot Washer, and we really had a philosophy. And the philosophy is, how do you really pay attention to students' interests and passions, give them real work? It's a design. Put them out on internships, in real problem solving, and then they think. Then they go deep. Then they get excited about their learning. So we started that with a high school in Providence. The Gates Foundation gave us money to then spread it. We had 10 schools and 50 schools in the country. Then we have schools in Australia and the Netherlands. And now we're moving on. We're also working with after school groups. We have some middle, some elementary, and I just recently started a college based on this design. So it's very exciting. We've been around 17 years, and it's just great to see now, even with the technology getting better, we know how to personalize. We know how to help kids find their passion, help adults find their passion, how to support them. And the technology is making us more efficient and allowing us to go more deeper. So it's been an exciting ride.
Well, there's a lot in there. And so I want to unpack some of that, because I think now, especially kind of with the help of social media and other things, the ideas you're talking about are talked about all over the place, right? Around student-centered learning, personalized learning, and doing hands-on learning. But you guys are really doing it as opposed to talking about it. And I've been to a MET school, and I've seen it in action. And I'm wondering if you can describe sort of the MET experience of how you bring that to life, because I do think it's very powerful and different from other folks.
Yeah. Well, what we do is, when kids come in ninth grade, we don't think they're too young to trust them, to put them out in internships. Right away, the first thing we do is we say, what are you interested in? They say, I don't know, money, sports, music. But we go at it. We have a whole curriculum that says, who am I? Who's your family? What are you interested in? And then they start making calls and saying, oh, I'd love to work at this vet. Oh, I'd love to work at the Humane Society. Love to work at the architect's office. Then they actually go out, remember, they're ninth graders, and get job shadows. And then if they find something that connects with their passion, then their advisor, who's their teacher, goes with them and sets us up. So from ninth grade on, every Tuesday and Thursday, our students are out doing real work.
Then and during the school day. This is not an add-on. Like, when people talk about internships in most places, it's, oh, that's something I do after 3 o'clock.
That's right. Yeah. And not only is it not an add-on, they don't even have to come to school in those days. They go right to their site. And the cool part is, the teacher's job, since they have all their students out, is to go from site to site and try to make sure that it's deeper. A lot of times people take internships, and nobody comes and checks at them. And sometimes they're not doing very good work, or they're doing menial work. We make it very important, because we develop a project that they come back Monday, Wednesday, and Friday, they work on this project. They might be translating something. They might be writing a grant for an organization. And that's how they get their math, their science, their English, mm-hmm. their social studies, all in that project. So what happens is they love it because they're doing what they love, yeah. real work. And then it's our job to keep making it broader and broader and broader.
You know? Now, one of the things, though, I know a lot of people, they hear about that and they think, I don't want to say it's soft, mm-hmm. but it's not truly academic. And yet I do know that you guys have a very rigorous standards for what you hold kids accountable to on the academic side as well. And in many cases, the kids are doing that and qualifying for four universities. So tell us a little bit about how that works.
Well, we use the term rigor, relevance, and relationship a lot. And rigor isn't just that you have a good curriculum on paper. It's how deep can you go? What do they know? Csikszentmihalyi, the researcher, says that the way to really become a great adult thinker, learner, is to study anything and study it very deeply. And so that's what we try to do. And so kids really know how to study. The kid who took his dad to Vietnam knew so much about Vietnam. Then he became a history major because he knew how to study things. And the rigor involved when you want it to be rigorous. When it's somebody else's work, you do it, you get done, you hand it. When it's your work, when you're writing for a magazine or you're doing a presentation at the zoo, that's your work. You stay up late, you do it well, and then we have to have very high standards to make sure that you're getting that depth, you're getting that knowledge, you keep improving as a reader, writer, and mathematician.
And this was a big part of your talk this morning here to the network, was around finding kids' passions. Why start with that? Why does that make the difference as opposed to that becoming the add-on?
Yeah, it's a great question. All learning starts from when you're interested in something. And when our kids come in ninth grade, no one's asked them, what are you interested in? They look, what? What's my plan? I don't know.
I'm only in ninth grade.
That's right, I'm only in ninth grade. Give it to me. But we make them to start thinking about that. So once you have to own their leadership, their learning. They have to want it. It has to make a difference. And so once that happens, they stay up all kinds of hours doing homework. They come in weekends to work because it's theirs. We have students now, we have an entrepreneur center. We have students starting their own business. They got to create. They got to figure out the finances. They got to do the advertising. It's their business. So they're working every day in the summer to get that right, where if I just said, okay, let's do this case study of a business, could be cute, but not really getting it.
Now, some people would argue, though, okay, that's great, and we all do that as adults. Why start that as early as high school? You get them a well-rounded education in high school, a well-rounded education in college. They have the rest of their lives to explore those passions. Why start at such a young age?
Right. Well, when you say they have, get them a well-rounded education. Unfortunately, they don't get that well-rounded education because they're not really learning it, because it's not really connected. I had one of my teachers, one of my best teachers from about 15 years ago, American history teacher. Tough teacher, highest standards, kids all did great on her final exam. I said to her, give that same exam to the same kids 3 months later in September when they come back to school. They all flunked.
Yeah.
She goes, I thought they knew everything about American history. They knew everything about American history that you asked them to memorize on June 25th. Mm-hmm. On September 10th, they had forgotten that. Take something that they created themselves, they don't forget. They want to do more reading. They want to do more writing. So it needs to start. I mean, the best time to start is when you're a youngster. If you look at kindergarten, that's a chance when people are starting to let kids explore. And then we kind of ruin things from first grade right up to graduate school. And then at graduate school, we start letting people follow their passion. Mm-hmm. If we do that all the time, if we help kids solve problems and find their interests and find what makes sense to them and support them, we will have incredible learners when they come out in the world.
Agreed. Now, you mentioned graduate school, so we should probably talk about that a little bit. You mentioned early on that you actually started not a graduate school, but a School of Higher Ed.
Yes.
College Unbound.
Yes.
Tell us a little bit about why you decided to do that, and then and what you've been seeing over the last few years of doing that.
Yeah. Well, I've been 40 years in K-12 education, and pretty successful, and I still enjoy it, and am moved by it. But I started seeing national data. If you're a first-generation kid going to college in your family, and you've graduated high school, you get accepted to college, doesn't matter what your color or nationality is, 89% drop out.
It's crazy.
So I go, only 11% make it? That is crazy. I can't believe that all the students, something's wrong with them. It must be the colleges. So because we have a design that can work with all different ages, mm-hmm. I partnered up with Roger Williams University, a university in Rhode Island, and they were forward enough thinking to say, hey, this is a different way to learn. And so to start, we gathered with students from all our schools around the country and got a house and put them together and really worked the same way, but in a much more intense way. Mm-hmm. So you're now 18 and you're now being asked that, and you really work around your passion, and you're organizing events, and you're meetings with the mayor, you're meeting with the governor, things that are so much richer than just the textbook. We kind of say it's life to text rather than text to life.
Nice.
You do it and then you read about it. It's mm-hmm. like traveling. Mm-hmm. You travel someplace. All our kids went overseas. They all raised money, went overseas by themselves to some third world country. Mm-hmm. They came back different people. It's a different commitment. Mm-hmm. And then we started seeing, as we started getting older students, that it was really these 27, 35-year-olds who had gone to school, dropped out, one of the statistics, had a low-level job, and would never get back in school. Mm-hmm. They weren't just going online, they weren't sitting right in their college. And we have figured out a way where they can come back to College Unbound at Roger Williams, they can stay at their job, that's kind of like their internship, and then build a project around that mm-hmm. that has the sociology in, the psychology mm-hmm. in, the writing in, and they do it as a project so they can go full-time to school. They don't have to take this one course a semester and get through in 12 years. They can get through, really become learners, and it transforms them. And Roger Williams also acknowledges the beauty of life credit. Some people are 50 years old, done great stuff. They give you up to 90 credits, and you don't have to pay for it, which is amazing for Roger Williams. And so we are really taking off now. Yeah. From businesses are calling us and saying, I'd like you to take my 100 employees sure. and help them be in this program.
Yeah.
And we help mold programs with them. So, and we're working with a group in New Orleans, the Ashley Cultural Center. Southern New Hampshire University has a group. So this is about to take off. And it's exciting to me because it's using the same design with another
right.
group.
Right.
So.
Well, that's what I was going to ask you about. I mean, you started small, only a few students, 10
yeah.
students in year
yeah.
one, and now you're up to your first graduating class.
Yeah.
And it sounds like it's transferable to other places.
Yes, it is. Yeah, it can really take off. And depending, you know, we're playing online in a different way with how you use the social media for people to learn together. Mm-hmm. And so it's going to be exciting, and it's going to take off, and it is a way that's a different kind of learning than just online or just in classroom or a combination. It's
yeah.
a different kind.
Sure, it's
so,
blended. Yeah.
yeah,
and we're very
yeah.
interested in that as well
yeah.
at New Tech,
yeah.
as you can imagine. So, one last question I have for you is, you know, as one of sort of our leading educational revolutionaries for the last 40 years, you clearly continue to march on and look for different ways to impact kids and adult learners and so on. What's next? Maybe, whether it's for you or for everybody else, where do we need to be heading next that we're not looking at right now? Where are our blind spots in education?
Yeah, I often say that it took 100 years for us to mess up education, and it may take us another 100 years mm-hmm. to clean it up. I asked my students who are here speaking with me, you know, what's the most important thing? And they talked about the trust, the teachers have to
yeah.
have trust.
Yeah.
So I don't know how we get that. I don't know how
it's cultural,
we
right?
relax teachers mm-hmm. enough to say, my job is to really help support, help grow, help guide, rather than putting information mm-hmm. into a head. I'm not sure how to do that. The technology has just begun to hit,
mm-hmm.
okay? And it's hitting the college area even stronger
yeah.
now, because they've been so 400 kid lectures. Now you got the best lecturers doing it. But I don't think that's the answer. That's just that's how technology usually starts. It's
lowest
a quicker way to do
efficiencies.
To do the old stuff.
Right.
But I think a lot of the gaming stuff. Mm-hmm. I think the whole idea of school is going to change because you can find information everywhere. I believe that students of all ages need support.
Mm-hmm.
So there will be places where people come together and have guides and can have a group.
Mm-hmm.
But I think a lot of the information gathering is going to be outside in a way.
Mm-hmm.
And hopefully when that technology gets better and better, you know, why do kids sit on the gaming board for that long?
Right.
What is it? But people got to understand that learning is about doing, not just about a mental activity.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, there's an example here. We're in the middle of a heat wave in the Midwest, and I've been watching TV and newscasters say that
mm-hmm.
for 10 days, and it only registered here. Now I'm here, and it's 105
right.
out. So I understand it better.
But we're in the lovely air conditioning.
Beautiful air conditioning.
Grand Rapids.
But I'm saying it has to be that life to text, and you have to match that. And I think we really need a paradigm shift, and I hope it can happen.
Yeah, so. We do too. Well, a great conversation as always. If people want to learn more about some of your work, books, big picture, give us some URLs for people to get to.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I'm at dlittky, L-I-T-T-K-Y. The easiest one is at metmail.org. I have a book out called The Big Picture, duh. And kind of talks about our philosophy.
That's part of the title, right? Big picture, duh.
Right? And Elliot Washer's just coming out with a book in the fall. I don't know what the final name will be. And you can go to our website, Big Picture Learning. So.
And on Twitter. Did I see you have a Twitter? Dennis_Litke?
Yes, yes. You have that, too.
You checking that?
So,
not enough.
Not on Twitter?
Man, okay. Well, maybe we'll force you into that.
All right. Very good.
Everybody can ping him on Twitter,
too.
Well, it was great talking to you, as always. Thank you so much for being at our conference, bringing your expertise, sharing with us, and we hope for many, many years of collaboration ahead.
And if you're not standing on the edge, you're taking up too much space.
You heard it from him right there. All right. Thanks for joining us on NTech Live. I'm Chris Walsh. For everyone here at NTech 2012, thanks for joining us, and we'll see you soon.